क्विक अनाउंसमेंट फॉर असाइनमेंट 5 आई हैव सीन दैट मेनी ऑफ यू हैव डन अ लेट सबमिशन लेट सबमिशन इन द सेंस दैट यू हैव सेंड टू अस बाय ईमेल और सेंड इट टू द टीएस बाय ईमेल वेल सो I will be creating a separate late submission page for assignment 5 today. So if you are not been able to submit assignment 5 on time, then please do the submission of assignment 5 through Moodle on that late submission portal. Well, now just remember that if you have already submitted in the original submission link as well as you are going to submit it on the late submission link, then we are going to evaluate the one that is there on the late submission link, and for the late submission we will have a 20% penalty in evaluating your assignment. Okay, so the late submission link for assignment 5 will be open till tomorrow end of the day. So if you are planning to submit it, do it. Okay, Vishak, over to you.
Yes, okay. So last week we covered Hyperledger Indy, which is used for decentralized identity management, specifically in the specifications of deeds and so decentralized identifiers and verifiable credentials and presentations. In Hyperledger Indy plays the role of a verifiable data registry. But of course, so Indy is used to store deeds in this distributed ledger as store the other artifacts which are required for verifiable credential and verifiable presentation workflow. For example, the scheme, the credential schemas and credential definitions, as well as revocation lists. So those functionalities are provided by Hyperledger Indy, but still one part, as we saw in the last tutorial, was missing, that how this communication between the two parties who want to exchange their identities will work. So in the last tutorial, we were using only one program, and we were writing only one program and managing both the parties or all of the participants in one program, and whatever process, whatever communication step was there, we were just copying some data from one variable to another variable, right? But in the in any real world use case of these decentralized identities, you need a robust architecture for handling all of them. So Hyperledger Aries is basically a project which tries to solve this issue or solve this gap, where we have a decentralized registry, but we want to use it for identity management. So Hyperledger Aries allows, I mean, provides us the necessary tools to enable communication as well as manage the identities in wallets and more, we will see. So this is the Aries architecture. Now here, if you see on the right hand side this diagram, there is the internet which have other agents. Now here agent means Aries cloud agent, which is one implementation of Aries agent. Okay, so Aries agent is basically the application which is run by one participant, and this Aries cloud agent is a Python. Here in the diagram we are showing the Python implementation. So one participant, say I will have one Aries agent. Now there will be other participants, and we can communicate to them through the internet. So the Aries agent has, I mean, these three broad components. We will elaborate on it further. So there is its core capabilities, which handles ARIES protocols, and this core ARIES module is communicating with other ARIES agent as well as the distributed ledger. Okay, so now this ARIES is one, but to write our own applications with the help of a decision, we need to write our own controller. So controller is a module which will be communicating with the ARIES agent, and it will be passing commands and getting back responses to and from this agent. And this controller will be implementing whatever business logic we want to have. Okay. So this ARIES Cloud Agent, or in short ACA file, exposes REST API to access the ARIES capabilities, as you can see here. And we as developers who are building applications will be writing a controller, and this controller will be sending HTTP requests, basically to execute commands, and it will be getting back responses here, some responses along with the requests. But in addition to that, it can get events through webhooks. So basically these are events which has to be received. So there will be many use cases. I can give you one example. Suppose we have this ARIES Cloud Agent running. So I am running this, and we have implemented a controller. So if you want to connect to the controller, will send a request, say that connect to this address. It will go to the core module, and the core module will parse the address and then try to connect to the ARIES agent of the remote control. Once this connection request is sent and the response received, this particular response will come back to the API and come back as a response to the REST API. Okay, which is fine. Now, so if you think about the remote agent who is receiving the request, then what is happening there? From other agents, a request is coming, and it is handled by the core module. That request is will come to the ARIES protocols, and now somehow this ARIES needs to inform your application or the controller that there is some kind of request or some event has occurred. So for that need webhooks. So basically your application will be handling some web endpoints, and according to the type of the event, you will get different kinds of requests in those endpoints. So this is the ARIES architecture in more detail. So you can see that there is this distributed ledger, which is basically the implementation of the deed, implementation of some deed method. Okay, so this is a blockchain network which implements one deed method. If say it is a sovereign, if you consider the sovereign network, then the method will be sov, right? SOV. So deed colon sov colon. So that kind of deed address will be used here. So this distributed ledger can be anything. So ARIES is implemented in such a way that you can actually use any kind of distributed ledger with it. So by default, it comes with the support of Hyperledger ND. So if you want to use Hyperledger ND, you can do that without any problem. So there is complete support for Hyperledger ND. If you want to use some other deed registry, then you have to implement the proper plugins. Okay. So now this ARIES Cloud Agent, the ARIES agent, will be communicating with the distributed ledger as well as other agents. So the communication part with other agent is actually handled by for communicating with the other agents, ARIES uses a protocol called DITCOM protocol. So we can see how that, so there is this com transports RFC, which define how these messages are formed and exchanged for communicating between two ARIES agents. Okay. So then we have, so there is this DITCOM protocol module also which handles the messages, and we have the REST API module which is responsible for communicating with the controller, that is your application, right? So we have communication in two directions. This is REST, and basically this can be over HTTP, or it is also supports REST over web sockets. And if you want to use some other kind of transport, you can also do that, but these two are already. And then for webhooks also same, your webhooks can be coming through, I mean, to an HTTP endpoint or to a WebSocket endpoint. So it supports both. So basically, if you think, then we have two broad parts, right? So first part is this ARIES Cloud Agent, which is entirely, I mean, which is like a tool that we can use. Okay. And then we have the controller that we need to write for implementing our own business logic. So this ARIES Cloud Agent is ARIES Cloud Agent has also more implementations. If we go to the ARIES page, so this is basically the ARIES project web page. So you can see that ARIES is infrastructure for blockchain rooted peer-to-peer interactions. So the main focus is peer-to-peer interactions, and now if you see, there are a bunch of projects here. So the first one is this ARIES base repo, and then we have Cloud Agent Python Framework .NET. So what are these? So if you open this ARIES repo, you will get some descriptions of them. So there are several ARIES agent implement, and they have their own characteristics. Okay, so we have ARIES Cloud Agent Python, the one we were discussing, is suitable for all kind of non-mobile agent applications. Why non-mobile? Because it is difficult to, because it is implemented in Python, and it is difficult to run Python natively on mobile applications. So for mobile application also, there are different agents. And then there is a .NET implementation, and also a Go-based implementation. So these are the, and but the most mature one and the most stable one is ACAPI, fine. And by default, ARIES embeds the Indie SDK. So it does not have support for any distributed ledger based identity management platform. Basically, it only supports Indie for now, but it is, I mean, it, you can easily extend it to support other ledgers. Okay. Right. So this Cloud Agent Python implementation, we are focusing on this. So we will be running it as a tool, and this tool can be configured entirely via command line parameters. So what you will need to do is you need to start this ARIES agent with the proper parameters, right? And then it will be interacting with other agents if they also share the, I mean, they also are using some compatible parameters. For example, if one agent is trying to use HTTP protocol, and the other agent must also be configured to use HTTP and like that. So the parameters should be matching. And then it also manages the ledger as a wallet. So if you, it can use Indie as its own wallet. Basically, if you choose to use Indie, then you, it will store all the deeds in the Indie ledger and save the deeds as fedi names. Can be, it can save the schemas as well as the credential definition, etc. Okay. And communicating with the controller. So the second part is controller, which if you are writing an application, you would need to write. So the controller will be receiving events from the agent, handling the business logic, and then sending requests to the agent using HTTP just on administrative API. So not exactly the administrative API. This is one part, one feature. So JSON REST requests basically. So how do we install and get started using Hyperledger Redis? So firstly, we won't be using Eris on its own. We will be using Hyperledger Indy along with Eris almost all. Because without a verifiable data registry, the workflows won't cannot be completed. So for a verifiable credential, for issuing a verifiable credentials, you would need schema definitions, and for presenting also you would need those, right? And also query names. So for that, a verifiable data registry is required. Otherwise, only running the Eris agents won't pass. Fine. So the first step is installing libindy and indy CLI. So this part we have already covered in the last tutorial, how you can use, install and use indy. So I don't verify if indeed installed, and you can use it. So if you open Python and write import in indeed, then we can see that yes, indeed. So basically, if it is importing, it's fine. So you can use that. Okay. Then the next step would be importing the Eris Cloud Agent. So that would be as simple as pip install. So I already have this installed, so it won't take any time. So once you have this installed, you will be able to see that it adds an executable called aca-py. Okay. Yes, so if this one works, then that means that it is installed properly. So next, you can of course check and play around with this aca.py or aca-py. So this is a version 0.5.1, and what are the modes in which you can use it? So there are only two commands, provision and start. The difference between provisioning and start is simple. So provisioning means you would be specifying which wallet to use, and if you already know the private key of an identity that you want to use, then it can generate the public key from it and try to attach it to the same way as we were attaching to the steward in case of Hyperledger. So you may provision indy and then start it. Otherwise, it is also possible to just start Eris. So it is possible to start Eris by passing the proper flags. So if you see aca-py start help, then it will show you a bunch of options that are possible. So these options are very important, and you can go through them one by one. I will be focusing on some of them gradually. And there are many options here. So have to be configured through these proper options. So provisioning a wallet, you can provision a wallet using this in using a basically, if you start aca-py without this wallet type, then it won't be using Hyperledger ND. Okay, so Aries will be just starting on its own and it will be using a local wallet and will not connect to any. Now, if you want to use ND, then by default, what will it do? It will be connecting to the ND ledger, but it will not have any deed registered. Right? You would need to create a deed, register it, and then ND can use that. Aries can use that. But if you want to connect to an existing node in Hyperledger ND, then you would need to pass this option. So this seed option is exactly the same one as we saw in configuring Hyperledger ND. So for stewards, we have some known seeds and we can use them to add to them and use the agent as a steward. So these are the parameters that we were talking about. There are many parameters. The required ones are inbound transport and transport. So you must specify this. So ACA PI start, then inbound transport is basically interface or the address where the Aries agent will be listening to for commands. So here in this slide, you can see we are passing HTTP. So it will be using the HTTP protocol, REST over HTTP, and then this is the address IP where it will be binding to, and then this is the port. So it will be listening to all interfaces and 8000 port, and the outbound transport is also HTTP. Right? So it is also, then you can use the Docker image, you can use Docker to run it. So what you would need to do is you need to clone Aries Cloud Agent and then run this script. So I won't go over these details. I won't be explaining this, but you can. This is an option of running CFI. Okay, so let us try to see how we can start an ND agent. So if you do ACA PI start, then it will show you that that there is an error. The following arguments are required: inbound transport and outbound transport. Right? Let us try with this one. Okay, fine. So it says that Aries Cloud Agent has started and this is the inbound transport. Administration API not available. Now with Cloud Agent running, I mean, it is possible to do some basic things, but if you want to validate if it is indeed listening to this port 8000, then what you can do is you can do NC localhost or 127. Now if I give some other port like 8001, it should exit, but if I do 8000, so we can see that yes, it is indeed listening to 8000 and accepting TCP connections. Okay, so this is HTTP, so but we don't know, but this protocol is internal to ND, so we don't know what HTTP request we would need to send, etc. So instead, for interacting with Aries, there is this module called the administration API. Okay, and we can use this administration API to actually experiment with different workflows and then once we have the workflows figured out, you can go ahead and write a controller. So I will show you how that will work. So this was the command we were using to run ACAPI. So in order to start the admin API, you need to pass these two options in blue in this slide. So -fn admin in secure mode and -fn admin, and then the address where it would be listening to, right? So let us go ahead and do that. Admin in secure mode and then admin . Okay, now the output is kind of similar. It is saying that it is cloud agent is starting and this is the inbound transport. Same, the additional thing is this one, right? So we have the admin API running in this endpoint. So let us go ahead and try to use this admin endpoint. Okay, so this is the admin portal. So this is nothing but the OpenAPI Swagger UI or Swagger representation for the REST API specification. Okay, so this is basically listing all the requests that are possible. So all the GET requests and POST requests that you can use to achieve different kind of functionalities with ARIS. And you can use, so let me go ahead and try to do one request. So wallet GET /wallet/JIT. So this will list wallet deeds. So I can go and try to execute this. So it returned me this result of an empty list. So we don't have any deeds in our wallet. Fine. So we can create a local deed using by having a POST ticket to /wallet/deed/create. So yes. So now we see that this deed is created. Correct. So now if you go ahead and try to list the wallet deeds again, so we can see that there is one deed that is there. So now some of you might be confused that what is this interface and how is it working. So this is just sending HTTP requests. Okay, so you can, instead of this, you can use any kind of any HTTP client. Let me try to show you using curl. So what do we want to do? So in the list of wallets, we have, I can just do a GET request for this. /wallet/deed. A GET request to /wallet/deed will be returning the list of deeds which are present in the ARIS wallet. Okay, so to do that, we can simply do, don't need this. /wallet/deed. Fine. So you can see that it is returning the one deed that we have. Similarly, you can do a POST request also to add, basically create a new deed that we just tried out. So this is POST to /wallet/deed/create. Okay, we have the curl command also. great. So you can use any kind of any HTTP client to do this. Okay, so what it is doing? So it is doing a post request to this admin API, and then /wallet/lead/create. Okay, so if you do that, then we see that in response we got back one lead, which is this one, 5PR, starting with 5PR. The last one was starting with FMB. So now if we do a list, so you see that there are two leads now, the 5PR one and also the FMB. So in this way, you can use any HTTP client to communicate with the ADS agent and write your business logic. Okay. So now we will be trying a workflow. Okay, so this part I missed, that this admin API or this admin in is only for experiments and debugging purposes. So if you are writing an application and trying to run it in production, then you won't be using this admin in secure mode. You can secure the admin with an API key. So if you run while running ACAPI, if you specify one API key, then it will secure the admin REST API with a key. And then you can use that from the controller. So we will try a workflow, and we will try a flow of issuing credentials where we will be starting two ADS agents, and then we will see how they can communicate or how they can issue a credential. Okay, so these things are not clearly documented in the ADS project. So what you would need to do is whatever documentation they have is basically this Swagger OpenAPI reference. Okay, so if from this OpenAPI reference, you can find out what are the different endpoints. So there are some groups. So server, which will be fetching the server status. So as you can see this one, the version of the ACAPI, basically the ADS agent server, and then some other details. Like server check. So server is regarding servers, then there is this basic message for passing messages over connections. Okay. Now what is the connection? Connection is a DITCOM protocol connection between two ADS agents. So if you see this connection group, then using this connection endpoint, so /connection will query the connections or fetch details about a single connection. Then we have a bunch of other endpoints for creating a connection. So setting up a connection has its own flow, like creating an invitation, receiving an invitation, sending a request, accepting a request, those kind of things. So once these are done, a connection is established, then send this basic message can be used to send messages. And more importantly, issue credentials. So these endpoints can be used to issue credentials from an issuer to a holder which have a connection between them. Okay. Then we have other endpoints also, like present proof, which is for making a verifiable presentation. And then we have schema for registering verifiable credential schema in the ledger, or basically whatever wallet you are using. If you are connected to Indy, then yes, Indy ledger. And then handling revocation registries. So I missed credential definition. Yes. And then once, apart from schema, you can also have credential definition. So the same things that you saw in Indy now will be handled by Hyperledger ADS. Okay, so in Indy you have to manually create a schema, then create a definition and handle all those things. But here ADS will simplify the process, and as well as ADS will provide these connections through which you can directly request for credentials and get credentials from one agent to another agent. Okay, so let us try to start with the, so the first step is, okay, let me just go ahead and close this one. So let us take a look at how did we start our ACFI ADC agent. We defined an inbound transport, outbound transport, and we have enabled admin, fine, and nothing else. So the first step in any workflow, or at least which uses a verifiable data registry, is creating or having a registered deed there, right? Having a very name in Indy. So let us try to do that. So we have a ledger endpoint. We have sending a name request to the ledger. So let me first take that deed. If I list my deeds, you can see that in my in this agent's local wallet, there are two deeds. This first one, and this is the second. Right. So I can go ahead and copy it somewhere so that I can use it later. Fine. So using these deeds, let us try to register one as a very name, so that we can use that for issuing credentials. So for that, we have post request to /ledger/register name. You can paste the deed as well as the verification key, fine, and then press execute. So what you see is error forbidden. Okay, so there can be many reasons for this 403 error, but why is it? But here the reason is it is not connected to the Indy ledger. Right? So we had started ADs, but we did not give any information about how to connect to the Indy ledger. So we have to do that. So before that, let us go ahead and start Indy, the Indy pool itself. We have started the Indy pool. Now, how would ADs connect to this Indy pool? So that is the question, right? So we will be passing a bunch of options this time. I will explain all of them one by one. So this time we are starting ADs agent start, and then all these options. So what do these options mean? The first two are fine, the inbound transport and the outbound transport. And the next two we have already discussed, admin insecure mode, accessing the admin without an API key, and then admin, which is specifying the address where admin will be, the admin interface will be binding into. Then this option is saying ADs that we will be using the Hyperledger Indy as the verifiable data registry. Right? So --, wallet --type space Indy. This one selects Indy as the ledger. So once you select this wallet type as Indy, the Genesis file parameter or Genesis parameter becomes mandatory. You have to specify either one. So we have our Genesis transaction in pool1.txt file, and this is the path to that. So the same pool.txt was used in Hyperledger Indy also when you try to connect to the pool. So this is how it looks. Remember that it has the IP and port of the bootstrap node. So whatever nodes are there in the network, it has that. So using this IP and port, ADs will also be able to connect to the next. We will have some wallet names. So you can give any name here, wallet name and key, so that if you somehow, if somehow your Aries agent stops or crashes, then the next time it starts, at least it will have all the artifacts. For example, the local leads, whatever credentials it had already received, it will be able to save all those artifacts in this wallet. Okay, and it will be protected using this key. So the next time you start the Aries agent, it can read those from the wallet and again use those. And the last two lines are for logging. So if you, we are enabling debug logging and saving it to this file. Okay, so let us start this with all these options. Fine, as you can see, it is started and it is listening to this particular administrative API 9001. Let us go to 9001. And let us go ahead and again try to list. So this particular endpoint fetch the current public deed. So fetching the current public deed is basically saying if it has some ready name registered with it or not, or if it is using that or not. So as you can see, if I execute it, it is returning me null. So this particular Aries agent does not have a public deed yet. So we can try to create that. Is having the similar steps. Let us see if we have any deeds in our wallet. We should not have. Yes, the result is an empty list. So we will create one deed for our wallet. So wallet deed create, send this request. So it has created one deed. We can verify that from deed this list execute. Fine, so we can see that the list has only one entry now. So we have created one deed. So now using this deed, we want to create a ready name, correct? So we can copy these two, deed and verification key. Go to the ledger endpoint. So we have this, send the name registration to the ledger. Now, if you remember the last tutorial correctly, you would already know if this request will succeed or not. But still, I will show you step by step. So it says 500 internal server error. Okay, so somehow registering this name request failed, having the deed and the verification key. So why? We can try to investigate from this log. So as you can see here, the target deed and the verification key is set, but the submitter deed is none. Okay. So what is happening here is that this particular Aries agent is not acting on behalf of her, and in India, only a steward can send a name request. So you can see that the submitter deed is none. Only if the submitter deed is a steward's deed and it is and the request signed by the steward, then only a name request will start. Fine. So as a result, we need a steward agent running. So how to run a steward agent? So let us keep this one running. We won't be closing this. I will open a new terminal. I can open a new tab here. Then I will be starting it on a different port. And everything will stay same apart from these two. Okay, so here we are passing a seed with the string seed for the square, and we are passing this replace public deed option. So what it does is it will construct the deed from this particular seed, and then it will try to use that deed obtained from the seed as its own public deed. So it will be trying to act on behalf of the steward. Fine, so it is running in 8001. Let us try to see if we can access it. So now here, if you go to list the valid deeds, execute. So it already has two more deeds in its wallet. I know why, because I'm using an older wallet. Let me just change the wallet name. So I'll be using a new wallet. Let us try it again. This time we should see only one deed instead of all those three. Yes, now we see that we have only one deed, and this is the deed of the steward. Okay, so this particular ADC agent running in 8001 is a steward and can submit NEIM transactions. So let us try that, if it can submit NEIM transactions or not. Ledger. Yeah, ledger register NEIM. Try it out. So in the deed we will paste this one. Verification key we will paste this one. Press execute. And you see it says success true. Right. So now this particular deed is registered in the ledger. How we can verify that? So from this other agent, we can use this query ledger / deed where key, get the verification key for a deed from the ledger. So I will pass the deed only, and it should return me the verification key. Yes, it does. Fine. So now my last step of configuring the deed will be to assign the current public deed. So one agent might have multiple DIDs, so you need to choose any one that you want to use for creating connections, getting credentials, presenting credentials, etc. So this is kind of choosing the default deed. So assign the current public deed. So we will choose this one, press execute. We see that this is successful. So now this agent also has one deed registered in the ledger. Okay, the next step would be some kind of communication between two ADC agents, and so there are so many options as you see, so it is not possible to cover all of them, but now you at least know how to send HTTP requests and or how to use this admin API to kind of interact with these ADC agents and execute whatever workflow you need. So we already saw how to create a deed and register it as VeriNEIM and set it as now in the next step, let us see if we can create some connections between these two agents. One is the normal one running in 9001 and this one in 8001 as the steward. So first let us query for any connections if anything is available. So the response is empty, so there are no current connections with this agent. So So to start a connection, we would need to create a connection invitation, fine. So let us create a new connection invitation. Try execute. So we got some big response for this connection invitation. So this is a response of the connection invitation. Okay, so it says that we have this invitation key. We have the connection ID, which is a local ID for identifier for that connection, and then we have this invitation. And we also have an invitation URL, which is not exactly a valid URL. So what is happening here is that even if we have an invitation, ADIS does not have any public endpoint, so it cannot create a valid URL. So somehow one ADIS agent needs to communicate with the other ADIS agent. Okay, so for that they must have some kind of defined. So in our case we can set the address to localhost itself. So let us see how we can set that. So there are two ways. One is through command line parameters and the other one is through the API. Let me see if the API is still there. Endpoint. No, there is only a get request. So the endpoint is currently null, right? So this we have to set the endpoint while we are starting the ADIS agents. So I have added this one option here, hyphen E, right? So let us see if now we have get some endpoint. So connection, create invitation, execute, great. This time if you compare this response, and you can spot the difference. Now in the endpoint, in the invitation URL, you can see that the endpoint is here, so it will work correctly, right? So we will be using this invitation. So this is connection invitation from the ADIS agent running on 8000 port. So we can copy this invitation portion and go to the other ADIS agent, and then we can paste. And you can try to receive this invitation or accept this invitation, right? Receive invitation. So as you can see, that gave me some output. So it has an invitation key. key. It has given me an invitation key, which is matching with the invitation request. And then it also has a connection ID. Note that these two connection IDs are different because this is kind of the local identifier for this particular connection. Okay. Next, we would need to accept the invitation. Connection slash ID. I think this will be the connection ID. Execute. Yes. So after accepting invitation, we have this output. Fine. So we can also use this connection ID to check the status of the connection. So what is happening with the connection. So we can go to connections ID. We got this response which says that initiated is external. So this connection was initiated by someone else, not me, and it is associated to a particular connection request, and it's created at this that there should be a state. Is that routing state is something different. Invitation mode once. Okay, the state is request. And state is request. So we have to go back to the first agent, and here we need to accept the request. Let me check what is the status here. So here also you can see that the state is request. So at least the state is same in both. So both the agents are on the same page. So what you can do is use this connection ID. I have already copied this one, 9CV, this one, and accept that request. Okay. Fine. The request is accepted and the state is response. Okay, so at this point the connection is already established. So we have the connection ID, this one, which can be used to do more work. Okay. So let me try this one. Does this work? Yeah, we got an empty response. So if you do tail, so this is a log. Okay, so let me. Execute. Yes, so basically the other ADC agent is receiving these messages, so the connection is there. And these messages are being transported through the DITCOM protocol, fine. Okay, so we can move further, we have time, so I will try to move further and try to do something more like issuing a credential. But you already know how we can use this API, and you can go through this Swagger documentation and do all the things step by step. Fine. So there is no separate documentation on how to use this. Whatever you have is here, this requests and the descriptions and the examples which are given here. Fine. So we have two agents. Both have their deeds registered in the IntelliJar. One of them is toward, and the second one registered its deed used through that toward, and then we created a connection through all these steps, and creating invitation in the one agent, receiving invitation in the other, accepting invitation in the other agent, and then finally accept request in this initiating agent. And through all those steps, connection has been established, and we saw that send basic message is working. Fine. So let us now concentrate on credentials. So how would we issue credentials and do those things? So the first step for creating and issuing credentials is we must have a credential schema that we would be using. So let us create a credential schema. So schema name, let us give it job, and then one field called experience. So let us keep it very simple just for demo purposes. So I will be sending this schema, and the post request is slash post request to the URL slash schema with this body which has schema version, the name, and whatever attributes it would have. So if you need to add more attributes, you would just add them by having commas here. Okay. So let me add one more. Execute. So we got this response that this schema is registered in the IndieLedger. So we have the schema ID now. The schema ID starts with the deed of the registrant. So basically whoever is registering. So this is the deed for the steward. And this entire string is the schema ID. So we can use this schema ID in the other agent also. So the other agent is also communicating with Indy. So from here, you can try to query this schema. Okay, so as you can see, the other agent is also able to access the schema from the IndieLedger. So everything is working fine at this point. So the next step would be creating a schema, a credential definition. Right? So to do that, you can have a post request for creating a credential definition. The post request has a body which specifies the schema ID that you want to use. So I would go ahead and paste the schema ID for the schema named job, support revocation, it is set to false, and tag is default. Okay. So try, paste, execute. It is taking some time. Okay, so the credential definition is also registered. So we have a credential definition, a schema by the steward, and the credential definition also by the steward. Fine. So now we can use them to issue a credential. So how to do that? There are several flows of issuing credentials that are possible. So if you see this issue credential group, then we have so many requests. Right. So we have send proposal, send offer, then records, credential ID, send offer, so many things. So one flow is that whoever is the issuer, send offer to the credential holder, basically who will be receiving the credential. And another flow is sending a credential proposal. So this would be sent from the holder to the issuer. So there are more flows possible, but we would be using the simplest one, which is just issue credential slash send, and in everything, sending the proposal, sending the request, sending the credentials, whatever those things were in Indy. So the master secret, etc. All those things will be handled in the background if you use the issue credentials slash send. So this must be executed from the issuer. Okay. So issuer will be sending the credential to the holder, automating the entire flow. So it needs a payload body like this. So what do we need here? We need the schema ID. We already have the schema ID. So let us go ahead and copy paste it. Okay. Some comment. Then connection ID, we will come back to this later once we have this. So we have the schema name. The schema name is job. Schema issuer DID. So whoever has submitted the schema, which is this first part. Schema issuer DID is the first part. Okay. Now credential definition ID. We have this credential definition ID. Issuer TIT. Schema issuer TIT and issuer TIT. So this will be the issuer deed itself. In the steward deed itself, issuing a deed here, credential here. Finally, we have the credential proposal. So this type you won't be changing. Okay, so this is something predefined, which is basically the type type of this credential proposal. So it specifies how what this credential proposal is and what should be its attributes, etc. So inside it, we can specify all the attributes that we want. So we have two attributes. One is experience and the second one is company. So both are texts and the value will be say 4 years and the company is fine. So this will be the attribute. So finally one thing is missing, which is the connection ID. So who will be sending this credential? The steward. So this one 8000. So we need the connection ID from here. Connections. Yes, active. So it is the ID here. Copy the connection ID from here. Then our payload is ready. We can go to credentials, send, try. So delete this one. Paste. And then execute. We got some error. And try to see what is the problem. Schema validation failed. Is missing data for required field. So this was the request. So are we missing something here? So name is experience and name is company. Okay, it is saying we are missing data form for some fields. Let me go ahead and check the schema again. Maybe we are missing something or we had added something in the schema or not. Maybe the schema. So we have attribute names, experience and company. Okay, there can be also problem with the schema ID, etc. So let us cross check those, the schema ID and then the attributes, fine. Schema ID is fine, then this format might be incorrect. Okay, let's try it again. So we are doing all of these steps manually. Ideally, we would be writing a program to do that. Since we might be missing some fields or some things here. Still, are we getting the same thing? Missing data for required field. Which field is required that I am not able to find? Target? What is target? We have a field called target here. I can cross check. So issue credentials, send, try it out. I don't see anything called target. Okay. Yeah, so the trace was true and something was missing in the trace. Fine, so now we can see that the credential is issued. So if you are facing problems, then this trace has to be turned to false, otherwise it might create problems. Fine, so we have this credential issued. So this, so it basically automates the entire process internally, but we still have the credential proposal, then the credential offer, and the final credential from the credential offer will be stored to the holder, stored in the holder. So we can go back to the holder and then we can see if we have some credentials in the wallet. Try it out, execute. Fetch credentials from wallet. So maybe it is not saved for some reason. You only have the credential definition only. I can check the logs if it received it or not. Yeah, so you can see that it received the credential, right? So in order to save it to the wallet, you would need to handle the webhook. Basically, the part we did not cover yet. Yes, so when the issuer is sending the credential to the holder, at that time the holder, it is an external request coming from the issuer, correct? So the holder will be receiving the credential, but you have to handle it somehow, save it to the wallet explicitly. So to do that, you will need to handle this hook, credential exchange record updated hook. Okay, so and after handling this hook, you will be able to, you can use the APIs to record that credential in your own Aries wallet. So basically, in this way, you can use the Aries agent or Aries Cloud agent, Python, this particular agent, and use those APIs to get credential issued. And similarly, we have the endpoints for presentations also. So we won't be able to cover everything in this tutorial, but the steps are quite simple, and you just need to follow them in correct order, and it is quite intuitive if you follow this particular Swagger OpenAPI reference. Fine. So we covered this issue credential, and the final step would be to present a proof. For that, we would need to create another agent who would be requesting the proof and then validating it. Okay. So we will end it here. If you have any questions, let me know. There won't be any assignments based on Aries, so it was just this tutorial. So if you have, let me know.
Thanks, Bishak. So as we have announced earlier, we will not have any assignment from Aries. This is just for your understanding purpose. So you can try it out yourself, and if you face any difficulty, you can get connected to it, Vishak, to explore it further. So any query from your side? So thanks, Den. So just remember that, as we announced earlier, that next Friday we'll have the final class test, that is class test 3. And then in between, we'll discuss about the different use cases in blockchain and how you can develop the applications on top of blockchain. And then finally, on November 18, on Thursday, we'll have the final quiz to wrap up the course. And also regarding the evaluation of the quiz and the assignment, we are evaluating it. We are done with assignment 1 and 4. Shortly, we are going to share that marks with you. We are evaluating the other assignments. So likely to be by next week, we would be able to share the marks of the assignments and the quizzes with you. That means quiz 1 and quiz 2. Quiz 1 has already been evaluated. Quiz 2, the TS are evaluating it. We are evaluating it. So by next week, we'll share all those marks with you. Okay, so Professor Shura, anything?
Yeah, no, that is fine. So I think, and for quiz 3, 4, and 5, you will be able to see the marks and all that. So immediately after the quizzes, so we have been making them available. So even 2 days also, it is all available. So 3, 4, 5. I believe most of you have already checked it because those are easily graded, and some that need a little bit of manual evaluation, that is only taking time. So that I believe only 2 is taking a little bit of time.
Right. Yeah,
that is it.
Okay, fine then.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you everyone. Take care. Bye-bye.